Welcome to the Amazing Race Canada 3 preview episode of the UR Team Number podcast. My name is Michael Harmstone, and joining me is one Canadian who, as far as we know, hasn't graced the cover of any romance novels, Logan Saunders.
Afternoon by 3 minutes.
You can tweet us using the hashtag yatncast, as always, or email us at yatncast@gmail.com. And it's a supersized season, both for the teams and for us.
15 podcasts? You're crazy, Michael.
I know, and that may go up, depending on where the season goes. You never know.
If we could do we could be season two and have a mid-season recap / reunion with just us two, so it won't really be much of a reunion. And then we could, towards the end of the season, do another recap and then invite James Duthie on, and then he can put our last names on the back of jerseys of a struggling sporting franchise.
Could we get the Harpies from The Social on, please? I miss them from season one.
Miss? I don't know if miss is the right word.
They add something. Are you showing that John Montgomery is actually a much better host?
We will give the people from The Social credit, though, that they, unlike James Duthie, would not have ignored skateboarding lesbians as Duthie did.
Very true. The people's favourites, I think you'll find.
Yes.
The Fuel Your Favourite Team poll was rigged in Natalie and Megan's favour. Laura and Jackie were actually second.
Yeah, Laura and Jackie were supposed to have a 9.0 rating, but I guess somebody just tampered with the results and dropped them down a few spots.
Yeah, they dropped them to 7.8. Too much skateboarding.
You're already with the Pokemon jokes.
Oh, I have many jokes over the next 15 episodes, Logan.
Yeah, we've got 12 teams to get through, and we're barely going to have enough time to get through 6 of them today.
And the first one is, in a twist, the team that you've met.
Yes, one of the two I met. This is pretty surreal, actually, because the team we're talking about first is Max and Elias. And Elias, for those of you not from Canada and don't watch the UFC at all, he was originally a contestant on the only season ever of The Ultimate Fighter Canada, well, The Ultimate Fighter Nations Canada versus Australia, where really it was just Ultimate Fighter Canada, since Australia had zero impact or real presence during the season, other than losing fight after fight after fight. But Elias was the winner of that, and he was just a complete goofball on camera, very likable guy. And all of the other fighters made fun of how handsome he was, because Elias has graced the cover of romance novels, and he's worked as a model and an actor before he switched into MMA. And after he won The Ultimate Fighter, he's had a really good run so far in the UFC. Probably could be one of the best Canadian UFC fighters on the roster right now. And last June, there was a fan event held in Kelowna, BC, here, not far from where I live. My brother and I went to that fan event in Kelowna for the day. It was just, all they had was a parking lot, and there's about 50 to 100 guys or so who were all MMA junkies that were all hanging out there. Way better bodies than I have, for sure. They really trained, you know. Nobody's going to pick a fight with anybody there, that's for sure. You didn't need any bodyguards to hire. He was one of the main UFC guests that was going to be hanging out there for the day. He did a whole UFC tutorial and a bunch of other crap. So this is really the first time of any Amazing Race season where I've personally seen a contestant in person before they were featured on the Amazing Race. So it's a pretty cool moment.
Which races have you seen after they've been cast?
That is probably zero as well. So this makes it double special.
So, as Logan says, he has graced the covers of 10 romance novels, according to CTV. And he's an MMA fighter, she's a retail manager, both from Ontario. And they've been together for 5 months.
Yeah, so, but they've already given themselves a celebrity relationship portmanteau name, is that what it's called? Yeah, called Milan. Max and Elias combined, in case you can figure that out. I think Elias is hogging most of that name, since he's occupying 5 out of the 6 letters in that portmanteau, but deservedly so.
Well, she enjoys horseback riding whilst also keeping his ego in check.
Yeah, they definitely balance each other out. I did appreciate in their 10-second Chevrolet video that they used all 10 seconds to make fun of Brangelina.
And the team that they most associate with is Body Break. Are they?
Because they love 90s workout gear.
Yeah, either that or they're going to swear at another team.
Yeah, keep that F off. Immortalized words in the Amazing Race Canada universe.
Much as Joanne does not want them to be.
Joanne will come around one day. But yeah, Elias is going to be a real goofball, and I think he may even match Suki and Jinder for just top Amazing Race characters, because
strong
Elias,
words.
I know strong words. I'm saying expectations high, but Elias has set high expectations of himself all his life, and look where he is today. But just especially at the fan event too, I do feel the need to point out that Elias did start a water balloon fight with Sarah Kaufman and a few kids in the parking lot, and one of the 8-year-olds snuck up behind him and just absolutely soaked him with a water balloon. And then Elias would do Ryu from Street Fighter impressions during the UFC demonstration. So he's just as fun and hilarious as he is on TV as he is in real life. So I think he's going to be a really good character.
You have to bear in mind, we didn't spot Suki and Jinder's potential in the preview last year. It took until, well, the start line for us to notice how awesome they were. So it's massive words to say that he could live up to the legend of the Atwells.
I do fear, though, that if Max and Elias make it a long ways into the race, that he could very well be made fun of for being a bit phony for television. Because he's just too, he's that charming of a guy where people may not think that that's real. Do you think Max is going to have one of the heaviest backpacks on the Amazing Race? Because she's packing 2 flat irons in her backpack.
How many flat irons does she think she's going to need?
I don't know, but I really hope that there's like a head shaving task, and if she does go through with that, then she can just ditch the 2 flat irons.
I am 100% expecting either a head shave or a tattoo this year.
Yes.
They've completely... The 3 fast forwards we've heard about have been the police car simulator, which was way, way too difficult and unaired. We had the searching round for all the signs with Alain and Andre. And we had the amazing, maybe my favourite fast forward they've ever done internationally, the nudity desk, the life drawing. So I'm fully expecting a head shave this year.
Mm-hmm.
Especially as they're going to India. Spoilers.
Did you see what Max, that one, that Elias' pet peeve about Max is? Apparently Max cries on command like a baby.
Yeah, her fears are needles and divorce. Is she a divorcee?
She's 2 years older than Elias. She's 28. She could very well be divorced by now.
And he sweats like a monkey, and his fears are failure and heights.
I wonder if how many times they will be censored on the show, because they do say that they do have a love of the swears.
Yeah, they're described as the team most likely to give network censors a heart attack with their love of the swears, which automatically makes me love them.
And they also love being in sugar comas and Chinese food, which is a very random combination.
Yeah. And noble intentions for the money. He wants to invest it, she wants to get a puppy and a Chanel purse.
Yeah, very noble. It reminds me of the Amazing Race 21, where they had the double your money prize, where whoever won the first leg then had a chance to win $2 million at the end of the race if they won. And the executive producer of the American version of Amazing Race, that Elise Doganiri, or however you pronounce her last name, she said it would provide a great opportunity for whoever won the $2 million to do something noble, like donate a huge chunk of the money to cancer research or something like that. So I really wish Max and Elias were on that season and won the $2 million and just, you know, completely pimp out their ride, you know, buy chihuahuas and dogs and crazy purses and Louis Vuittons and just go through the $2 million in like 2 months flat.
And a final quote from Max and Elias. Winning dirty, always winning dirty in the end. A winner's a winner. Let's be honest, it's a game. The ends justify the means. The only time we would seem to play fair is if it worked to our advantage.
We definitely have the right mindset. I mean, you got to think that Elias is probably the most competitive person they've ever cast for the Amazing Race.
You mean Trina and Tennille weren't competitive?
The twins, I mean, I would put the twins in my top five, but I think they may be just a step below Elias. Deodoro. Where do you have Max and Elias ranked, by the way?
I like them. They are one of my favorite teams.
Do you think they'll go far?
Yeah, I think they will do pretty well. I'd love to see them have to face a head shave in India, because I do suspect that's coming. I'm not sure they can win, but I think they'll do pretty well.
I hope so, too. This is probably the most biased I've ever been about an Amazing Race team in the 35-plus seasons I've seen. But I think they'll make top three as well, just based on the rest of the competition in the field. And my hopes.
And now, the most boring races in the cast. Dana and Amanda, who are cup friends from Newfoundland and Labrador. And they met when they were 15 and competing in rugby and cheerleading against each other.
I think they're more victims of production, because it seems like production, more than anybody, is really trying to push the whole young female cop thing. Like, they're making, like, because producers always choose the clothing you're going to wear for the race. Most of the time, anyway. That goes with Survivor or Big Brother. They choose your wardrobe because they want you to fill a certain archetype.
Well, as well as that, they want you to have the same color clothing, so it's really easy for the audience to tell who your teammate is.
Yeah, it's not like the earlier seasons where everybody could just wear whatever the hell they wanted. But with Dana and Amanda, I just feel like production, they pick the blue because apparently that's the cop color. And just really, that's all that's listed in their bio, is just them being police officers and being from the Atlantic Canada. So my opinion is that there's probably way more to Dana and Amanda that producers are allowing us to see. But within the confines of Amazing Race Canada, production just doesn't want to let them have a personality.
Also, did they specifically go out to find someone who looks identical to Spooner? Because Dana is a double.
Yes, I can see that.
I could not believe it when I saw their cast photo. I was like, have they cast Spooner again? Because she is an absolute spitting image. And it's kind of weird. And obviously they compare themselves to the Olympians because, you know, young, fit female team are always going to compare themselves to the Olympians now.
All they need is a broken hand.
Yeah. Yeah, let's hope Amanda doesn't break her hand to fulfill the legacy.
So with comparing Dana to Spooner, are you saying, Michael, that she may or may not vomit approximately 17 times by the end of a season premiere?
Including during a skydive.
Including during a skydive, yes.
I'm interested to see what their high-octane task is going to be in Leghorn as well. Because we had the jumping from a bridge in season one. The sort of half bungee jumping, I suppose. We had the skydive last year. They've done a high octane task both years. I'm interested to see where they're going to go, because they are staying in country for the first leg.
I guess with Dane and Amanda, they did say that they both practiced driving a stick before the race. I guess people are finally learning that lesson after 14 years, because I believe in Max and Elias's bio as well, they said that they learned how to drive a stick too. So everyone's learning that lesson.
Yeah, it's a lesson that needs to have been learned. Because as much as we love Mike and Roe, that was their one weakness.
Well, with Mike and Roe, they didn't really have the opportunity to drive a stick, though.
Also, Mike's not played me at Splatoon yet. I'm very disappointed.
Maybe he's playing with other Amazing Race podcasters. There's a secret podcasting Splatoon league that you have not been made aware of.
Throwing shade out there. Listen, I've kicked Logan's ass enough in the past couple of weeks. I need a challenge.
Hey, I try my best at Splatoon, thank you very much.
You're very trying, Logan. But I did tweet out a couple of rather fun pictures, where it's just my results screen. One of them last weekend was like 1,700, wasn't it?
1,700 points to my 600 points. Yes, yes, we all.
What we need is the Unreal Tournament announcer going, dominating. And Dana's strengths are listed as target shooting, hashtag never give up Dana, organization and playing football. And her biggest fear is mice, and she hates that Amanda is forgetful. Which is really awkward given that Amanda lists short-term memory as one of her skills.
Mm-hmm.
And she's apparently a perfectionist, Dana.
Yeah. What I am probably most choked about with their bio overall is that their walk-on song would be a song by One Republic.
They just lost
any chance of me being a fan of them right there. One Republic is one of the worst things to happen to music. Not as bad as Nickelback, but it's pretty high up there.
I did not expect a rant from you with regards to One Republic.
However, Dana balances out, or it's either Dana or Amanda, balance it out, because for one of them, I can't remember who it is, their hometown is a place called Wabush.
I can't remember which one it is either. I think it might be Amanda.
But that's just the funniest sounding name. It's like the most, if I had to come up with a list of just comedic town names that Atlantic Canada could get away with naming, Wabush would probably be fairly high up on the list. They should have been nicknamed, I think they're being nicknamed like Teen Young Cops or Female Cops or something like that in their bios. That would be their team hashtag, but I think they should have been nicknamed Team Wabush. The Wabushinators. The Wabush Whackers.
The big question for them is, are they goofy enough to be newfies?
How goofy is your newfie? How loose is your goose?
Exactly. And their tactic quote is that we're honest girls, we're not deceitful, and we're not out to get anyone. We're not making friends, but we're not making enemies either. We're going to play the game our way. So basically, they are taking the entire strategy from the Olympians.
Yeah. The thing with having law enforcement teams or Canadian hero teams, like we'll in the next podcast, we're going to be talking about a couple of athletes, I think, who really want to represent themselves well. And that's always a problem, is that with a job like law enforcement or being in a sport where you're representing Team Canada, you really have to preserve your image on television. Like, because they're representing the community that they come from. So it's not going to be like, you know, Gino and Jesse, who are, you know, are a Zamboni driver, where they don't really have to worry about being in the public eye or, you know, just being well-respected within their own community, where they can just do anything with these law enforcement teams. That's something where they really, they're almost using the race as a platform in a way, I guess. Because they really have no other choice. Otherwise, they just look bad, and then you're going to have those, you know, those casual fan idiots ranting on the Amazing Race Canada Facebook page saying, no, they set a bad example for cops, and then you have to be like, no, they're just ordinary, regular people. Shut your mouth.
Yeah, I don't think he's ever going to get to a Big Brother 15 level. Oh, I don't remember saying those things. Where I believe nearly a quarter of the cast lost their jobs by the end of the season. I think it was 3 of 16.
Yeah, the unemployment rate didn't go up because of a bad economy. It just came, it shot up because the people were speaking inappropriately on reality TV shows.
Thank God we haven't got any of those awful people this season.
So, with Dean and Amanda, I don't think they're going to do well. For some reason, I can't put my finger on it exactly why I think this. But I don't feel like their mind is in tune with something like the challenges that will present itself on The Amazing Race. I feel like they have a different type of intelligence that's much more fitting for their role as cops. But for some reason, I don't think it's going to translate too well to The Amazing Race Canada. And I do have them as being one of the first three teams eliminated from the season.
Didn't actually expect that.
No?
No, I think they're going to make a reasonably deep run. I certainly don't think they're going to win. I certainly wouldn't necessarily want them to win, because I don't think they'd be very interesting winners. But I would probably say at least sort of sixth, maybe fifth.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to be anywhere near the level of all-female teams we've seen in the past year, like Kim and Allie, who I was really gung-ho for right from the preview podcast of Amazing Race 25. I just don't see it with Dana and Amanda. I could be wrong after the premiere, because we have very little information to go by so far.
But we were very accurate last season. We had a very good run last season. With Sarah and Nabila being first boots, obviously, most obvious first boots ever.
Yeah, nobody's standing out as a first boot as Charlotte and Nabila. I'm not saying that about Dane and Amanda, that it's going to be like that they're just going to be, you know, just dead in the water before the first 10 minutes of the season. But with Dane and Amanda, I just don't see them lasting, just based off of the bios and based off of their Canada AM interview clip that I saw online.
Yeah, I'm not high on them, but I think they'll be one of those teams that sort of sneaks through towards sort of the last third of the season before going home.
Do you think Mickey and Pete are high on them too?
Mickey and Pete are high on very many things, Logan. Especially thanks to their winnings. And now, a team that people expect me to hate, and I actually don't hate them as much as I probably should, Brent and Sean.
Dramatic Designers, hashtag Dramatic Designers. My
sort of irritation at flamboyant casting is quite well documented. I'm not a big fan of this sort of team, but I don't hate them as much as I probably should.
So you're saying that they're not quite giving you maximum Joey and Megan vibes, is what you're saying?
They're not giving me Joey and Megan, Frankie Grande, that sort of vibe.
That's a very good thing, but they're not on the opposite end of the spectrum where you have a team like Oswald and Danny from Amazing Race 2 who I think when they were conceived upon birth for each of them, that they were just conceived of a sperm and an egg, but within that just a whole lot of awesomeness, like the most awesomeness sperm and the most awesomeness egg.
Yeah. Or like a Team Guido.
Or a Team Guido, very good example. For viewers listening out there, if you have not listened to our very first Amazing Race interview with Team Guido, please go to yatncast.wordpress.com or in our iTunes feed, I believe, is where our interview is with them.
It is indeed on our iTunes feed, which I will obviously link to in the descriptions, but also there is a short link which is bit.ly/yatncast-iTunes. And it's the very first episode that I uploaded.
Mm-hmm. How special.
Podcast number 53, GuidoCast.
We love you, Bill Bartek.
We do. We love you, Joe, as well. Can't neglect Joe.
Yeah. But with Brent and Sean, I listened, I read their bios, and then I watched their Canada AM interview as well. And they actually had a really good interview. I think they're going to be pretty good in confessionals.
What is going to annoy me is that CTV are blatantly wanting them to be fan favourites. During the first paragraph of their bio, the words charm, quick-witted, unforgettable, laid-back, down-to-earth, endearing, and fun-loving were all used.
Wasn't Underdog in there somewhere as well?
Underdog was also in there later in the bio.
Yeah, that's the problem when... See, the thing is with teams, when we talk about who we may not like as much as we want to or dislike as much as we should, you know, a lot of that is contributed by, however... production presents them. That's just the bottom line. It's editing plays a huge part. So if any teams are listening to various podcasts or reading blogs, you know, we really don't know your whole personality. We really have to try our best to read between the lines, but it's also balanced out by our frustration with however production presents you.
They are going to be presented as 100% fan favorites. They are not going to win 100%. They're going to probably Ryan and Rob their way to the final leg and lose. But CTV are going to try and make them win the Fuel Your Favorite Team poll.
Mm.
That's my prediction.
But they're not even Olympians.
No. Well, that's why I said they Ryan and Rob it instead of Natalie and Megan it.
Did you see what fruits they compared themselves to? It's a very interesting kind of combination.
I did, but I can't remember which one it was because that question was so stupid. Of all the bio questions this year, the walk-on song one was a bit whiffy. The fruit one was even weirder.
I know, I think it was that Dean or Amanda said, they said, oh, Amanda said that she's a blueberry because everybody loves blueberries. But yet, blueberry is my personal favorite fruit, so what she said is factually incorrect, which is pretty bad for a police officer to do. But with Brent and Sean with these fruits here, this is a combination. Like, this is line after line, so this is just, I don't know if they planned this coincidence or not, but Brent said that he is a banana, and then Sean said he's a kumquat. And that was back to back, and I'm thinking, come on, guys. Come on, that would be a joke I would make.
I said this to Ben when their bio was released, but they are trying to push the very, very flamboyant card. Between associating themselves with Vanessa and Selena, their good luck charm being Pinot Grigio, their walk-on song would be Glamorous by Fergie, which is a song I've not heard since about 2006.
Whamolous. That's how Fergie pronounces it. Whamolous. Gwamolous. This is the worst cover of Gwamolous anybody will ever hear.
It's Fergie trying to sing without teeth.
I think Brent and Sean should just spell out their last name one letter at a time when they're introduced on the show, just so they can be like Fergie. Just be like S-W-E-E-N-E-Y Sweeney. Sweeney. Also with a W, just like Fergie's Glamorous.
And like seven different races in this season, Sean is scared of snakes. And Brent becomes our new Charla. He is scared of weird food textures. They're blatantly applicants, not recruits. But I just think they're slightly getting on my nerves.
They actually had a really good casting story in the Nerdcanada AM interview. I don't think this has really been written about too much as of yet. But they said when they were cast for the show that when they were going through the interviews and the phone calls over the phone, because I think they still lived at their parents at the time or something like that, and they would just sneak off to their basement to talk to the casting producers over the phone and just kept it a complete secret from their parents until they knew 100% that they were going to be on the Amazing Race. So, yeah, so about 5 or 6 days before they left, they said, oh, guess what? We got cast for the Amazing Race Canada. We're probably going to be out of the country by the end of the week.
Yeah, which is a great tactic, because how many people have been bumped off casting because they've told people and they've blabbed it?
Yeah.
I mean, we very nearly had that for Amazing Race 27, and I kind of wish we did.
If this were Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, Brent and Sean would definitely work as the secret keepers at Grimald Place.
I solemnly swear that they're up to no good.
That's the Marauder map.
So where do you have Brent and Sean placing?
It depends, because Sean said he even packed his shower curtain in his backpack, so he said it's super heavy.
Yeah.
So if he comes to his senses and lines up the backpack, because if you have a really heavy backpack, that can hold you really far back on the race. Like, I know Heather and Eve in Amazing Race 3 were suffering from back problems in their four rounds of play, and look where that got them. But with Brent and Sean, I think they'll be quick learners on the race, and I do see them finishing somewhere between fourth and sixth place. In the words of Tommy Hilfiger from the short-lived reality show The Cut, I think at the end of the race, we will be quoting Tommy Hilfiger and say that they just didn't make the cut.
I hope that they're going to defy my expectations, but I'm not 100%. I think they're probably going to get saved by a couple of non-eliminations like Ryan and Rob did and sort of squeak their way into the final three.
Will we be referring to them as the Beasts of the East, or is that title only going to be reserved for Bam Bam Bigelow?
No, they're going to be referred to as Team BS.
Ooh.
Sass.
Oh, Michael, that's them fighting words, Michael. They're going to send your car careening down a hillside as you watch it go down.
And on to another potential fan favorite team, Hamilton and Michaela.
The Canadian version of Nick and Star, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, they met in Military Cadets 6 years ago, became best friends, and are now in a relationship. And Hamilton has been transitioning from male to female for 4 years.
I think we should start off talking about Hamilton Michaela by saying,
Michaela.
No, it's Michaela. I'm pretty sure it's the same pronunciation as Michaela from Survivor South Pacific. I think there's going to be a pretty big FU to the BB17 producers because Hamilton was technically the first transgendered contestant to be filming on a reality show in North America. But Audrey Middleton from BB17 is going to earn that distinction because BB17 airs live, and it just started in the past week. So Audrey's going to get all the credit for being the first transgendered contestant to be featured on a reality show in North America. And Hamilton's just going to have to settle for the silver medal, as John Montgomery would say.
The one thing in their bio that sort of stood out to me was the fact that they've already traveled to 13 European countries together.
Yeah, they're wise beyond their years by far. They probably have more travel experience than teams that have raced in the past that are in their 30s or their 40s.
I'm pretty sure they've traveled to more European countries than I have.
13, really? Don't you just get on a train and just go in a circle, and then by the end of 24 hours, you've knocked out a couple dozen countries?
Depends where you are.
With both of them being 19, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that a record for smallest combined age and Amazing Race history, just to slightly outdo Claire and Michelle from Amazing Race Asia Season 4?
Yep, they are 100% the youngest average team or average age of any team ever.
38. That's about 30 years. That's about 80 years younger than Bill and Kathy from Amazing Race 19. And I guess Hamilton did a similar proposal to Alain by proposing at the Eiffel Tower.
Yep, he proposed under the Eiffel Tower, and one of the teams that they most associate with is Alain and Audrey, because they bicker but love each other, and she also said yes!
Yeah, and we should note that during that proposal under the Eiffel Tower, several stories above in the Eiffel Tower, Lenny was still looking for the Arc de Triomphe. Lenny!
I bet you've missed them, haven't you?
Yes, I have. It's been a long 15 years. but with Michaela, I think she might be a bookworm because she has a dog named Shiloh. And if in the Canadian education system, because I'm only 4 years older than them, I'm 23, going on 24. When I was in the fifth grade, we had to read a book called Shiloh. And it's like a 3-book series, I think. And it's all about an abused dog, essentially. So I think she may have intentionally named the dog after a book.
Maybe they're just massive fans of Brad and Angelia, since they do have a child called Shiloh.
You know the names of celebrities' kids?
Yeah, having said that, I have no idea how I know that. I'm a fountain.
All I know is that somebody, I think it's Gwyneth Paltrow or somebody, has a kid named Apple.
Yeah, Gwyneth Paltrow and Chris Martin.
Yeah, I think Jill and Thomas from the Amazing Race 17 would probably name it Apple as well. He took kid naming 301 in university.
How are you doing on Amazing Race 17? Just out of interest.
I'm about 7 or 8 minutes into the 10th episode.
The infamous Hong Kong episode.
Yes. I did watch the ending out of curiosity. I think a favorite screen cap of mine is going to be Nick Lane in the boat while Vicky still searches for the right shipping number.
The Hong Kong episode is one very good reason that Amazing Race 17 is by far the best recent season. It's just, it's glorious. And then the fact that Nick and Vicky are basically an afterthought in the Final Four episode in South Korea. It's just even funnier. The fact that it sort of gets to the pit stop and then you go, oh yeah, Nick and Vicky were also in this, weren't they? They had a speed bump. Oh yeah, they had to clean a tank. Which is a badass speed bump, can I point out. But we saw nothing of it.
That's funny.
So Hamilton and Michaela both work in the service industry. One of many teams that has euphemistic job titles, but apparently he works for Timmy's, Tim Hortons, which instantly makes me love them.
Yeah.
And his biggest fear is heights, and she interrupts him all the time.
She fears ticks.
Yes, her fear is ticks. I'm not sure whether it's on the insects or on a piece of paper.
I think she may fear ticks because she didn't really like 90s cartoons all that much. And just wasn't a big fan of that source of comedy and stays very far away from the world's most comfortable chair.
I have no idea what you're referencing.
The Tick.
All right, never seen it.
You've never seen The Tick? You've never played The Tick for Super Nintendo? So this reference that I've been planning for the past 2 weeks fell completely flat.
Yep.
Damn it.
Not good.
Not good. Oh my god. He referenced The Tick. And they're from a place called Centerville, which we don't know if it's located dead center of Nova Scotia, but for the purposes of this podcast and the fact that neither of us live anywhere close to Atlantic Canada, let's just say it is.
To be fair, there's probably not much in it as to who lives closer.
Yeah, that is true.
You're probably closer, but only just.
Barely, yeah. Here in the West, being a West Coast mother Canucker that I am.
And apparently Hamilton and Michaela will play the game fair. That's how they roll.
That's how they roll. Like a cinnamon roll at Tim Hortons.
One of their many pastries that they can let us endorse and give me free stuff, please.
Yeah, are you just, after the race is over, are you going to fly back to Canada and you're just going to go to Centerville, Nova Scotia and find Hamilton and be like, hey, you know, give me some free Timmies. You know how much I've endorsed your guys' products over the past 2 years?
Yeah, Logan knows for a fact that I love Tim Hortons. When I've been to Canada both times, I've loved Tim Hortons. In fact, I have a Tim Hortons mug downstairs. Because they're awesome. And it's what made me very happy when Second Cup came to the UK last year. Because I could actually get Canadian hot chocolate again.
Oh, glory.
Oh, glory. So, what are your predictions for Hamilton and Michaela?
I think they'll be right up there with Max and Elias in the top three. I think this is going to be a pretty fun team to watch. And because of the trailblazing nature that they are for reality television.
Yeah, I think they will rival Brent and Sean as being one of the favourite teams, the fan favourites. I think they might be the recipients of the depressing Final Four elimination. Because both seasons, a fan favourite team has gone out in fourth place. And both times it's been horrendously depressing. And I think they may be the recipients of it.
I can see that. They just choke under the pressure, the anticipation and the panicky nature of youth.
Or get an absolutely bull task at the end like Jet and Dave did.
Maybe they'll be in the final three with like Nick and Sabrina and Gino and Jesse, and it's going to be like Italian-Canadian trivia as the final task, and they're just going to be completely screwed.
Oh god, I hope Nick and Sabrina beat Gino and Jesse. Just as a spoiler for in about 10 minutes' time, Gino and Jesse are 100% my punching bag this season. They have the worst bio I have ever seen.
And we'll get one step closer to that, because speak of one of those Italian-Canadian devils, I'm also an Italian-Canadian. Not as quite as much as them, though. But we're onwards to Nick and Sabrina.
We are. And they are a newly dating team, only dating for a year. He's a former professional footballer and goalkeeping coach, and the only racer on this season that I know has a Wikipedia. And they're both from Quebec.
Quebecois.
Yes, they are our traditional Quebecois team, who will be, no doubt, very angry to each other at some point.
Or just angry with James Duffy. And James Duffy has to try and control an ongoing conflict.
I suspect they will be very good TV.
Yes. Because not only is the one contestant named Sabrina, but they also compare themselves to, they say they're like the Timms and Nikki and Pete, and oddly enough, they're both winners. So, coincidence or not, that's really working in their favor.
That is the single greatest way to answer that question. Who are you like? Every winner of this franchise before.
Yeah, somebody on the Amazing Race 27 should have been like, I'm like Robin Brennan, Chris and Alex, Flo and Zach, Riken and Chip. Yeah, Riken and DK, sorry. That's his real name. Freddie and Kendra. That's unfortunate. And then just keep going on the list. And then some new fan to The Amazing Race is reading their bio, and they're like, oh my god, this is one gigantic spoiler for all 26 seasons.
Yes, which team are you like? We're like the Linz family.
We're like the Linz family. Yes, we fart in Amish carts, and we get into fights with super religious families.
And they say, despite the fact that they've only dated for a year, they already know they're getting married. So they're blatantly going to be a proposal on the race.
Well, that's what Quebecois teams do. They have, you know, just grand proposals on TV. But because Sabrina's last name is Mercury, when Nick proposes to her, instead of Sabrina saying yes, she's going to be like, I said, I will rock you. That was a queen joke, by the way. Sabrina's going to be the queen of this season. They will rock us. They will rock the viewers. And they will not bite the dust. They will not bite the dust.
Only the good jokes die young, Logan.
So and there's going to be a Zanzibar leg next season, just in their honor.
Anyway, their one massive sort of tick mark for me is that they both grew up speaking four languages, English, French, Italian, and Spanish.
I'm surprised they don't speak German.
Yeah, which will serve them very, very well. I mean, the English and French are sort of logical because, you know, Canada. Italian is obviously pretty logical from them being Italian-Canadian. But The Spanish will serve them very well. It's pretty much the second most widely spoken language I think it's overtaken English now.
Yeah.
And also, it will come in very handy for them pretty early in the race, given we have two Spanish-speaking countries on this race.
I think Donald Trump failed his job to the fact that Spanish has now surpassed English as a more spoken language. Donald Trump must be just fuming right now.
One of the things that they enjoy doing is arguing with each other, my sort of people.
I can, as somebody of great Italian ancestry, I can vouch for the fact that this is a great pastime.
As someone whose family ran from the mafia. And they also say in their bio that they would make accessible healthcare and education for everyone if they ruled the world.
Mm-hmm. That's a very Miss America type answer.
Yeah, given that Nick's LinkedIn says that he's a recruiter for Canada's Liberal Party, that doesn't surprise me.
So he does have political leanings that could clash with other teams in the race, especially given this cast, because with the fact that we have athletes and law enforcement, that's not to say all of them, but those are typically very strong-willed, thick-headed people who may not have flexible opinions about things, because that's just the way you're raised in those environments. So I could see Nick getting into heated arguments with other teams over his own strong political beliefs and the fact that he probably does have a very that very Italian mindset in terms of just his personal beliefs.
Being fiery,
but not watery, because both of them are just terrified, petrified. Petrified is the word they used in their Canada AM interview to describe their relationship with water, which is surprising because they're from Italy. You're surrounded by water, pretty much.
Yeah, and also, where does Nick want to go more than anywhere else? Somewhere with a coastline.
Yeah.
And his pet peeve is her driving, and her pet peeve is his road rage.
That's a lovely combination. That is not going to end well.
I cannot wait for a self-drive leg with these guys. And they have literally the same strengths, patience, loyalty, and strategy.
Just to drive home Nick's Italian-Canadian roots just a bit more, he compares himself to that if he was cast for any sort of acting role, he would be like 1970s Al Pacino, just in case he couldn't grasp the Italian-Canadian roots.
Mamma mia. What a mistake in America.
One day I'll break out my Marlon Brando impression on this podcast. Maybe after he uses the U-turn or something, or after Nick, or not he as in Marlon Brando, but he as in Nick, orchestrating some sort of big Amazing Race Canada alliance.
Big twist announcement during the season. Marlon Brando is going to be taking over one of the team's places.
I mean, make Monty an offer he can't refuse.
Their strategy is, we're real competitors, we're honest and we want to be honest. We're not here to make friends, but we're not here to be rude either.
I guess Nick, what he wants to bring onto the race, and I think Gino and Jesse said this as well, for some reason the two Italian-Canadian teams thought of this, but the item they most want to bring is a smartphone, and it has to come with endless roaming.
Yeah, a smartphone didn't serve a former footballing team in Amazing Race Philippines very well. Because they are the only team that I know of that got a 24-hour penalty for contacting their mother. They rang their mother to say, oh my god, the Amazing Race is awesome. Got a 24-hour penalty for it.
That's hilarious. That actually happened?
Yeah, Antonin Ahmad. Philippines won.
That's a very Mark Wahlberg thing. Maybe Mark Wahlberg went by and said, hey, call your mother, say hi to them for me.
They checked in, like, second place and then got bumped down to 10th place because they contacted their mother.
Wow, that is... I thought, like, maybe Margie and Luke had a mother's boy thing or a mama's boy or maybe Tony and Dallas, but or Susan and Patrick especially. But this just takes it to a whole new level. But yeah, it is hilarious that Nick wants to... that his favorite destination to travel to is Madagascar. You said it was because of the... that there's a coastline there, which makes no sense for his fear of water, but maybe he doesn't know enough about Madagascar and he's just basing it entirely off of the movie franchise.
He just wants to see talking lions and zebras.
Yeah. He's just gonna show up and be like, there's no talking lions and zebras, there's just catacombs and we're surrounded by water. This is the worst.
So how do you rate Nick and Sabrina's chances?
I went back and forth on them. Initially, I had them finishing around 6th or 7th, I think. But just they emphasized how they're just night terrors about water. That knowing how Shala and Nabila handled water last season, and knowing that we're still going to have a huge chunk of this race take place within Canada, that I can't help but feel that they're going to be eliminated sooner rather than later because of it. So I put them, I think, anywhere between the 10th to 12th range, but I'm thinking more like 11th or 12th. Like, I just don't see them handling this if they are terrified of water this much. That's not good.
Yeah, they do have a plan for it, though. Sabrina's going to do any watery task. And I'm assuming it's going to be, like, deep water rather than, you know, just being in a paddling pool.
Yeah, that's a huge difference. I know with Survivor Pearl Islands, with Sandra and Austin, that they had conversations about how... I think Sandra has gone, had practiced swimming laps in a pool or something like that, where she tried to get into the water a little bit. But then once you get into the ocean, it's a whole new ball game.
Yeah, I don't think that they're going to do a recreation of the task that eliminated Shala and Nabila. So I doubt that there's going to be a really, really deep water task. There might be one in a swimming pool, but I don't think they're going to, like, dump them in the middle of the ocean.
But really, the only places that don't have a ton of swimming areas in Canada in terms of lakes and rivers and oceans is the prairies. And that's the least visited location on the race, so...
And I don't think that they're going to the prairies much at all this season.
Yeah, because there's really not a whole lot left to do there. Like, the only... For the past two seasons, I've kept saying that the only major prairie location that they've avoided, other than Calgary and with Saskatchewan, Winnipeg, is that the only real major location I can think of is Edmonton. That's because I've personally been there myself and know there's a lot to do. So if they do hit up Edmonton this season... There's really going to be no other reason to go to the prairies after this season.
Yeah, I think I'm higher on Nick and Sabrina than you are, but purely because I don't think they're going to give them too many deep water tasks. I think we might see something with snakes because of how many teams are scared of them, and that would be hilarious. But I'm not 100% that they're going to bow out because of a water task. I don't think they'll win, but I don't think they're going to be an early casualty.
Yeah, I don't think they will quit a water task. I just think that they're going to have a really, really tough time with it. In terms of, I'm just picturing somebody like Shala Nabila and then, say, Rex and Bob in that surfing task last season where they took a 3-hour penalty.
I don't think we're going to get a Shally horse.
A Shally horse? But yeah, I want them to last a while, though, because they seem like they're going to be an entertaining team, especially when, because I think Nick is 22 and Sabrina's 32.
Yeah,
and on top of that, they look a lot like Cormac and Nicole. So they just have that visual Cormac and Nicole physical features, plus they have a similar age gap between them, so...
I don't think he packs any long trousers either. Every single image I've seen of him is him wearing shorts and leggings. I pointed this out for Amazing Race Australia versus New Zealand as well. Because, like, Tyson did the same. John off of Murray did the same. I seriously don't think he's packed any trousers.
Yeah, I think Amanda from this season, she said that leggings are a must-have for her as well.
As far as I know, he's the only person in recent memory to actually wear leggings in his promo pick.
Yeah, Lululemon's really, really catching on. Really catching it on for men, I guess, after all these years.
Well, it does kind of make sense given that he's an athlete, but still.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I know, he's the only one.
And they chose to wear red because of their fiery red personality. Or because production told them to, and they already assigned too many colors to other teams.
I love the question about why did you pick your team's color, because they blatantly didn't. Production did. But there's like three or four different red teams. Because Brian and Cynthia are red as well. And obviously it's Canada. Everyone's going to want to wear red.
Yeah, for sure. It'd be funny if there's going to be this one season down the road where they let teams pick their own colors. And it's like, that'll be the opening task is first come, first serve, pick your colors for the race. And it's just shirts, pants, and underwear just in the various colors. And you've got to run half a mile or just some ridiculous distance at a really quick pace to try and claim a color as if you're playing the board game Risk.
So should we move on to team number 6?
Oh, your favorites. Your Gene. Your Gene from Survivor Amazon.
Fucking Gino and Jesse.
Their last name is almost Montana, so it's very fitting that way. Their last name is Montani.
I looked at their bio and thought, I really don't want to hate you, but this is the worst bio I have ever seen. It is terrible. It is just so riddled with things that I go, that is so feckin' stupid for you to write that, despite the fact I know they're allowed to write the bios afterwards if they want to change anything as well. So they have chosen to keep all this stuff in the bio.
With this season, there are seven out of the 12 teams are from Ontario, which is the largest percentage of any of the three seasons. Usually they keep it 50% or lower in terms of Ontario representation, but this season is the first one to be over 50%. And I think out of the 6 teams we've discussed so far, only Gino and Jesse and Max and Elias are the only 2 out of the 7 that we're talking about on this podcast are from Ontario.
Yeah, because Brent and Sean live there, and then there's a couple of more Eastern teams as well, like the wrestlers are Eastern as well.
Yeah, so with Gino and Jesse, on the Amazing Race Canada page, one of the more popular complaints. By the way, this is a good time to plug my weekly blog that I'll be doing for this season. It's called the Funniest Complaints About Amazing Race Canada 3. And it's just copying, pasting complaints from the Facebook page. I don't attribute it to anybody specifically, but I don't reveal any names of who said these quotes. But it's just a collection of complaints that we see from week to week on Amazing Race Canada. And then I respond as to why casual fans make these ridiculous complaints, and then try to respond as to why they shouldn't think that way. And one of them is that fans online, before each season of Amazing Race Canada, their biggest pet peeve is that every province and territory isn't represented. You've seen this too, Michael, right? Like, this gets complained about a lot.
Yeah, I mean, for such a nice, easygoing nation, Canada does whine a lot with it when it comes to Amazing Race Canada. If you consider that before episode 3 last season on the Super Kawaki sized birthday edition, we did talk for half an hour about why casual fans were wrong to complain about international travel. This is not something that is new, sadly.
But because in the States, when they do the Amazing Race, there's 50 states. It's impossible to cast 50 teams for the Amazing Race for the American version each season. And because the headquarters for casting is based in LA, a lot of the teams are going to come from California.
I've seen World Race Productions. I took a photo of it deliberately when I was in LA.
One day I'll make it there. The mecca of Amazing Race television. And then, but with Canada, we only have 10 provinces and 3 territories. So with a 12-team season, you could, if you really wanted to, cast a team from each province and territory, then say condense Nunavut and Northwest Territories to form one team because they're really low population. But because headquarters for casting for Amazing Race Canada is based in Ontario, a lot of the teams each season are going to be coming out of Ontario because not only is it headquarters, but it's just as, but it's really diverse area as well as BC. So that's why they always dominate casting for each season. And it's just really expensive to go into the prairies and try to pick out a team. It's just costly.
Yeah, and also when your casting from the prairies revolves around people like Zach and Ashley from Big Brother Canada, it kind of says a lot.
Yeah. You may not have much to offer, guys. But so there was one of the more popular complaints that got a lot of likes on the Facebook page is that there was no teams from Alberta, and then Gino and Jesse, because they want to be the fan favorites, trying to get a jump start on it.
That is not going to happen.
They said, hey guys, we lived in Alberta for a while, so we're going to represent you. We're going to be Team Alberta. And it's not really going over that well, because it's like, well, no, you're really, you know, from Ontario, and B, your heritage lies in Italy too. So you can't claim every single geographic region on the planet. Before you know it, they're going to be like, oh, we went on a trip to Cancun for the weekend, so we're going to be Team Cancun, Ontario, Alberta, Italy, all rolled into one.
Yeah, I tend to agree with the fans generally as to who a fan favorite is going to be. If they are a fan favorite, I will be so surprised. Because they seem like they are my biggest chance at being right about a villainous team. I think they're going to be the villains.
I don't know they're going to be much of anything, to be honest, except not in terms of personality, but because they're both alpha males. They're both well-rounded. They don't really have any sort of outstanding weakness. They're physically fit. Gino has a geography degree, and the only person that jumps to mind in terms of having a geography degree is Chris from The Amazing Race 6, which led to her and John doing very well at navigating and map reading. So with Gino and Jesse, out of all the teams out of the first three seasons of Amazing Race Canada, there really hasn't been a team that has had a more prepared bio to do well on the race.
But they come across as being complete dicks. Stuff like their tactics being winning dirty 100%, what are we here for? We're here to win. Not everyone remembers the losers. And then the shameless stuff with the claiming Alberta. That doesn't bode well for me in terms of them being a nice team. They're going to stick around for far too long. They're going to annoy the absolute shite out of me. And I will be very happy if they ever get eliminated.
And it'll, you know what I'm going to do, Michael, is that I'm going to, you know, I'm going to talk to Jesse, and once I upgrade to a smartphone, me and you are going to exchange cell phone numbers, and I'm going to go to Jesse and pay him $10 through PayPal to text you KK through a text message.
Oh, that will legitimately annoy me, especially if he means to say okay. I mean, I'm not being wrong here, am I? That is the worst pet peeve of any bio.
Mm-hmm.
Gino's pet peeve is that Jesse texts him KK instead of okay. I have three words written here for them. Get a life.
I thought you were going to have two letters for them and they were going to be FU.
Yeah, FU would have been another good one, but get a life works.
You don't have to hate them so much, Michael. I mean, everybody is entitled to one team of irrational hatred each season. For instance, during the Amazing Race 15, there may or may not have been a Poke player that I did not like going into the season.
A Poke player? That's beyond white trash, darling.
With this season, this appears to be your team of irrational hatred.
It's not irrational, though. Their motto is losing is not an option. Unless they are the love children of Eric and Jeremy and Mark and Robson, that is not going to happen. You are going to be so pissed off when you don't win every single leg.
Okay, well, what are your thoughts on the group? I think I got this name right. What are your thoughts on the group, the Swedish House Mafia?
I don't really have many thoughts about them. They're all right, I suppose.
Have you heard of the Swedish House Mafia?
Yes, I have. I am aware of the Swedish House Mafia's.
Okay, because I'm not. Because I was thinking, well, maybe Michael will know about this group, and maybe that will be the one redeeming quality the common ground that he can find with Gino and Jesse, because Swedish House Mafia, a song of theirs, is what they picked for their walk-on song.
Yeah, what would be your walk-out song?
What would be mine? Yeah. Is it walk-on or walk-out?
Either will do. Walk-on song, I think, is the term they used in the bios, but...
Maybe next week we can have an Amazing Race Canada semantics podcast.
Yeah.
But my walk-on song, surprisingly, is not to be Four Fours Get Down.
Which it should be.
Which it should be. In the words of Dan Foley, I don't disagree with you.
It's a Canadian classic for the ages.
But I would feel compelled to go with the Canadian group because I think only one team from this season chose a Canadian song for their walk-on song.
Yeah, it was Brian and Cynthia, I think, who did.
Well, older people tend to know more about Canadian music, so that doesn't surprise me. But especially like Canadian folk music, like what's that crap, like Anne Murray or Celine Dion or... You know, one of those other singers out there.
I thought Celine Dion had claimed Swiss heritage now.
Yes, but I would probably choose a song by Prozac. Maybe It Sucks to Be You, which would be a fitting song if I'm a front runner during the race, or if I go home early. Or I would probably go with one of my favorite West Canadian hip-hop groups, so I would go with the song by, say, Swollen Members or Sweatshop Union. Or Rascals, and that is not Rascals with an S at the end, it is Rascals with a Z.
And if I had to choose a Canadian song to be my walk-on music, it would be Robin Sparkles' Let's Go to the Mall.
Ooh, could you explain Robin Sparkles? Because I guess there's probably going to be some Canadian listeners who might know who he is.
North American ones definitely should. It's from How I Met Your Mother.
Okay, that makes sense, because I did not give a crap about How I Met Your Mother. I wonder if the Bare Naked Ladies will make a song called 3 Weeks as the next part to their song 1 Week, and it'll be named 3 Weeks just to reflect the filming schedule for Amazing Race Canada. That's a walk-on song that people can use.
It's been 1 week since you got to see cheating lovers and cousins at Mary. Obviously, the team that they most associate with is Jet and Dave because they want to be fan favorites. Not going to happen.
Wannabes!
Yep. And they, with the money, they want to buy a cottage, toys like ATVs and motorbikes, and take their family on holiday.
Hopefully it's their last holiday.
I'm the one who has an irrational hatred over them, and yet you basically kill them off. And Gino apparently has a hard or rough exterior and a sweet, colourful interior. Way too much information. Jesse is full of flavour and liked by everyone.
I mean, they're even... Like, to go back to their regional claiming random places around the planet, their colors, it's not just blue, it's Azuri blue, because that's the Italy soccer colors. And I think, what was it, Gino or Jesse that, I think it was Jesse that had the high school football, American football injury that prevented him from pursuing his athletic dream, so... It's crazy that him and Nick have that parallel where they're both Italian Canadian. They both suffered some sort of strange injury in their late teens or early 20s that prevented them from being a professional athlete. And then they get to both be cast for the same season of Amazing Race Canada.
Well, I would say that Nick is a lot more successful because Nick actually did play for 3 Italian clubs.
Mm-hmm. He has a Wikipedia page.
Which means he's successful. And Jesse's favorite travel destination is, of course... Probably my least favorite place on the planet. I have mentioned it many times, Las Vegas.
And yet it's going to be probably the first place I visit once I get my passport this year. I need to be there to judge, though. Like, you went there before you were allowed to gamble, Michael. If you can't gamble in Las Vegas, that would be like going to Quebec and just being terrified of poutine.
I would say, if you want to go somewhere tacky that is a little bit of a shithole, but at least has some redeeming features, go to Niagara Falls.
It's Rainbow Falls. Rainbow Falls.
It was Rainbow Falls when I was there. They, like, turn the falls different colours at night. It's just what they do anyway. But Niagara Falls is actually awesome. If you're going to go somewhere in America, go to LA, because that's cool. At least has redeeming features, like, you know, theme parks. And good weather all year round. Las Vegas is just... hot and awful.
But I like the desert. I live in the desert, Michael.
Yeah, but Vegas, there is literally nothing for like 200 miles in any direction.
That's the beauty of it. Well, except that underground super secret nuclear facility.
Yeah, there is no redeeming feature of Vegas, having been there.
All you have to do is just find the toxic waste, roll around in it, Michael, and you've got superpowers.
Superpowers would interest me. And Gino falls asleep in films, which is a legitimate peeve given their prices.
Especially in England, you said, right? It's like the equivalent to $20 Canadian to see a film?
Yeah, it's about $15 to $17. It's a ridiculous amount of money.
So you're saying that Gino is just... It's like Venezuela with having oil at 0.0003 cents a liter, where people are just swimming in oil, and then Gino has access to cheap movies, and he's just taunting you by not really watching them. He's like, who cares? I can just, you know, pay $5 and I can just sleep in them the whole time.
Basically, Michael wants to watch popular movies for a cheap price, and Gino's laughing at him.
And that's just rude. You've had to put up with the expensive movies their whole life, and Gino just sleeps during them.
And probably my favorite bit of their bio is Gino's fear, the worst fear that anyone ever has, the one that always annoys me every time it appears in a bio. Gino's biggest fear is failure.
Which, ironically enough, in your eyes, fails as an appropriate fear.
Oh yeah, it's a complete failure. It's a complete failure of a choice.
If I was on Amazing Race Canada, I would admit that besides thunderstorms being my fear, biggest fear, it is in a tie with sock puppets and wooden popsicle sticks. Three-way tie.
If you did get on Amazing Race Canada, you would have to just put loads of Yatncast references in there, like being afraid of popsicle sticks or failure just to wind me up.
You know that one day those popsicle sticks are just going to rise up and take over the world. And Shaw and Nabila are going to be the first casualties, and as they're taken down by these popsicle sticks, Shaw's last words are going to be, "I told you so, guys. There's a reason why I fear wooden popsicle sticks."
Yes, her last words will be, "I'm so sorry."
Charlie horse.
Dare I ask where you think that Gino and Jesse are going to place?
First, I think on this podcast, we have discussed the most likely final three combination for this season. I think it'll be Gino and Jesse, Max and Malias. I'll refer to them by their celebrity name. They burn that. And Hamilton and Michaela. I think that's going to be our top three for this season of Amazing Race Canada. And they will be on the podium.
I hope you're wrong about them. I hope they crash and burn.
And do you think that if Gino and Jesse were to win, that much like last year when Mickey and Pete took off their pants at the finish line of celebration, that Gino and Jesse are going to follow through with their promise by swallowing tangerines whole?
They're going to be the sort to probably take their shirts off as well, which is also something that annoys me.
Well, Gino just wants to show off his tattoos.
Yeah, when they're just pandering for camera time. Ugh.
Although we probably know another hole where Gino and Jesse could probably shove those tangerines, though, in your opinion.
Well, in their mouths would work for me, because it'd shut them the fuck up, but... I can't wait to hate on them, because they're going to last forever. That's all I have to say.
We're going to be like the only two people on the entire internet who will just mock Gino and Jesse week after week. And no one's going to figure out exactly why we have this hatred for them on a weekly basis.
Until they listen to this preview.
Until they listen to this preview, yes.
But yeah, I really could do with them going very early on, but I don't think they will.
Do you think they'll be top three?
I think they'll be probably... I think they might go out in about Alain and Andre, fifth, sort of sixth place. I'd like to see them do a Pierre and Michelle's and completely crash and burn, but...
Not gonna happen.
Yeah, I hope that they cock up, especially if it's a geography-related fail, so that I can mock them mercilessly.
If it's like geocaching or something like that, or it's one of those rounds where you can only use the provided maps on a self-drive leg.
Yeah, I hope that they have a massive flaw, like they can't drive a stick shift.
Oh, I should point out, I would like to add one more thing, is that a lot of these teams said that their preparation was to do memorization tactics to improve their memory, because in Amazing Race Canada, more than any Amazing Race franchise out there, we have a ton of memory tasks, and people are finally catching on after two seasons that this tradition may not go away, but it would be hilarious if producers this season did not have a single memory task, even in the final leg. Just erase all memory tasks, and then teams are going to realize that they went about their preparation the wrong way.
I would love it if there is a completely trolley memory challenge, one that nobody is expecting.
What shoes were the pit stop greeters wearing?
Yeah, something like shoes, or sort of currencies is always a good one, but there's only going to be four.
What is the fifth word that John Montgomery said to you at the pit stop each round?
Exactly. Be like a Mole UK style clue.
Yeah.
If you've ever seen, you'll know what I'm referring to there.
But it'd be funny if they did like a Mole like quiz at the end where they said, on this leg, which seat was I sitting at the table, starting with Gina when Jesse's right?
What license plate did you drive on this leg?
The team with the lowest score will get executed on live television.
So, team number 7 is Susan and Chanjeet. So, they are co-workers in a women's correctional facility, and they are both apparently bossy.
Like Khalees.
And they are described as feisty, which by default makes them Aston and Christie.
Yeah, I'm sure all the viewers, when they were reading through Susan and Sharonjeet's bio, were immediately comparing them to Ashton and Christie from The Amazing Race Australia versus New Zealand.
I really hope that they get into a fight and tell someone to eat a bag of dicks. They would just make me so happy.
A few days ago, I don't think you saw this, Michael, due to region blocking, but there was a special called Ready, Set, Race that aired on CTV. It was hosted by Devin Sultanik, who used to be a VJ on Much Music. And I guess during season 2, Devin did all the tasks with John Montgomery, including a tandem skydive on the opening leg of last season. And I guess when Devin was talking to one of the other teams, it might have been Max and Elias. And Max looks a lot like Khaleesi from Game of Thrones, by the way. I don't know why I didn't point that out last week, but I think they said that they saw Susan and Sharonjeet that they saw where she was doing insane aerobics in the gym, and then we discover that Sharonjeet does CrossFit.
So they're more 20s than anything, then.
Or Dennis and Isabel, the Cambonese team from Amazing Race 25. So hopefully Susan and Sharonjeet become as legendary as Natalie and Nadia, and not so much as Dennis and Isabel. Otherwise, they will be out very, very early.
Hopefully, they'll be Natalie and Nadia the first time around rather than the second.
Not so much the second time.
Actually, you talked a lot more about CrossFit the second time, I think. I'm not sure how much into CrossFit they were the first time. And did you notice what their lucky charms are?
Each other are their lucky charms.
Pass me the bucket. I'm determined this week not to go on another rant, but, ugh, cliche!
Speaking of the India location being in the press release, Susan's parents are from India, so if they make it that far into the race, you know they're going to be hogging a lot of airtime during that round.
But yet again, the curse of the 20s could strike again. The 20s go, like, 4 rounds later, they go to Sri Lanka.
Mm-hmm.
And with the prize money, they want to set up their children's futures and, of course, travel to India to volunteer.
Yeah. Did you know that, you know how teams were in their bios were said to give themselves a pop duo nickname?
Some of them were. I completely ignored this question because it was so vacuous and awful.
They were one of about 2 or 3 teams that said that Sugar and Spice would be their pop duo name. So hopefully when they ask this question next season that this answer is forbidden, because way too many teams answered this in the bio. So who's the real Sugar and Spice is going to be the question for this season.
And of course, because they're a female-female team, they most associate with Vanessa and Selena.
Is that just the default answer for... Because what would be the distinguishment, you think, between a team that compares themselves to Vanessa and Selena and a team that compares themselves to Natalie and Megan?
I think Natalie and Megan is more of a game bot team, like Dana and Amanda, for example.
Where you just don't have that much personality and all it is just it's all just about athletics and not so much personality.
Yeah, whereas Vanessa and Selena are more of a team that gets a penultimate roadblock rigged for them.
Yeah. For anybody out there listening, we ragged on that penultimate roadblock in the first season of Amazing Race Canada about every 4 to 5 podcasts. It is probably the Canadian version of the hay bale task seen in the Amazing Race US or the find the one Blu-ray disc that shows your clue out of 10,000 Blu-ray discs in the Amazing Race Asia 3.
It firmly falls under the category of utter bullshit in task design. No other term for it. It's just an awful, awful production decision in a season that was actually pretty good. But that drags the season down by a couple of points. The fact that Vanessa and Selena had that stupid roadblock rigged for them. And the fact that Jet and Dave, who are still probably my favourite team from season one, got busted because of it.
Yeah, they're overrated. Surprisingly, their walkout song is a song with Ludacris in it. So right there, Susan and Sharjeet are just shooting up to the top of my list of favorite teams for this season. You know, on a scale of Gino and Jesse to, say, Suki and Jinder, they're closer to the Suki and Jinder scale end of things.
Please, please, if you get on talk, can you make your walk-on song be 4-4 for me?
Just for you, Michael. Just for you.
Mainly because I just want to expose Ben to that song. Because I think he'd approve.
And, of course, on a slight note where that makes Susan Sharjeet get a few points taken away from them, it is yet another law enforcement team on this season.
Yeah. I kind of hope that the law enforcement teams just go pretty early. I mean, as we predicted, Dana and Amanda are going to go pretty early. I don't think Brian and Cynthia are going to last that long either.
Yeah, if there's one team that I want all the other law enforcement teams to go right away, but I want Susan and Sharon G to stick around, especially when their story is more interesting because they're correctional officers, which, between the male prisoners where they work and also it being a male-dominated field, it's a bit more interesting that they have that job specifically.
So, one final thing is that Shanjeet is scared of gnomes.
You know, if she was on the Amazing Race US, she would be the worst person to have to talk about Travelocity, because there's always the Travelocity gnome, roaming gnome, in every season of the US version. So it's a good thing that Sharjeet is Canadian, and also Filipino according to her bio, because she said that she was born in Manila.
Yep, she's the thriller from Manila. I would love to see Sharjeet do the Namibia roadblock from the last season of Amazing Race US, where they just have to run through the desert trying to find the roaming gnome.
She would just go take off in the opposite direction of where the gnome landed, probably. She would probably just run all the way to one end of the desert and then come out on the other side and then find the gnome by accident.
So, how do you rate Susan and Shanjeet's chances?
I don't know. I feel like they'll be 6, but they could be cut off earlier because in their Chevrolet 10-second clip, when either Susan or Shanjeet was speaking, right in the middle of their sentence for why they're going to win the race, it's the only time out of all the Chevrolet clips where the video ended by clipping their sentence midway through. So all we know is that they're going to kick some butt and bring some, then it cut off. So I don't know what their whole MO is going to be. But I have them finishing around 6.
I think that they will improve upon the legacy of their forerunners, of Shala and Nabila. But I don't really rate their chances higher than sort of about 7th.
You don't think the female minority team is going to do well this season?
No. It's a trope that happens every season, that a female minority team usually doesn't last that long.
But unless it's Vanessa and Selena.
Unless it's Vanessa and Selena, and we've already talked about that. Yeah, I have them finishing somewhere sort of about the last third. I would say it's 7th or lower for them, really.
Yeah, the one thing working for them is that they are probably one of the most physically fit teams there, as opposed to, say, Shell and Nabila last season, who I don't think did any physical preparation for the race.
I am still mourning the fact we didn't get to see their burkinis. Because they have such cute outfits. I still don't know how I can remember most of Shell and Nabila's bio.
Yeah, they were bragging about that in their bio. I, 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 I moved on from Shaolin Nabilo's biographical information, but thanks to you, Michael, we get to bring it up in the preview podcast every year.
They're such amazing race legends. They're the only team who could have kept Jen and Sean in the race, and only just by the look of things.
And so you're saying that they're essentially the Lisa and Joni of Amazing Race Canada?
They are a top 25 team in Amazing Race Canada, easily, despite having one of the worst averages of all time. So, shall we move on to Brian and Cynthia?
I guess so. We can knock that out in about 10 seconds, I think.
They want to be the new small-town sweethearts. They're really not going to be.
Yeah, they're really aiming to be the new Mike and Rochelle, but they'll come up very, 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 very short.
They met while serving in the Canadian Armed Forces. They're now both police officers, and they somehow associate with Natalie and Megan, which just tells me they have no personality.
Yeah, I think if I had to rank the most boring teams out of the three seasons of Amazing Race Canada, Jody and Corey were always at the very bottom of that list for me, where I just found them to be boring before, during, and after the race. But I think Brian and Cynthia are going to set the new standard, because just their bios, like, did you see what their team nickname was in the Loop article? Team Us. Team Us. That's it. That's not a team nickname. What nickname just says Team Us? If anything, the only time you see those two letters is if somebody is capitalizing them to represent the United States.
Like with the Women's World Cup tonight.
Yeah. But here it's like just Team Us. Just capital U, lowercase s. The word, two-letter word. Us.
They just don't excite me at all.
Their only positive that I can really say about them is that they have a Dave and Rachel way, or a Frank Garrison way from Survivor Africa way of speaking, where they use words that nobody else really has really used in the past 20 years. So I think that could work in their favor, where that could provide some funny dialogue when they, in their bio, they say, oh, situation pending, or they're going to be tactical, and a bunch of other really technical, very, you know, specific words that they use. Very stiff words, I guess. And I think that could be funny at times, but I don't see anything else that provides any promise that we're going to receive any entertainment value whatsoever from this team.
They are very lucky that they didn't appear last season, because he's afraid of fire. So when they went through the off-air simulation, right before Charlotte and Nabila's infamous task of putting out a firefight, he would have just been like, nope, penalty.
Yep. And Charlotte and Nabila would still be in the race. Or both teams would probably be gone, if anything.
I'm really disappointed that they didn't last longer. Can you imagine Shala and Nabila going to Hong Kong, for example?
I'm just picturing her with the snake vial.
Exactly. There was so much comedy. As much as I love Jen and Sean, there was so much comedy potential that was lost when they went out.
Imagine if Shala and Nabila went to the Bruce Lee statue and had to do a Bruce Lee pose, and Shala gets a Charlie horse during the pose.
Never give up, Shala. Never give up.
Never give up. She just trips and falls around the statue. Or a Charlie horse during a very mental task, like the poker game thing where they played the game in the casino in Macau, and then they're trying to figure out the numbers, and Shala just winces and grabs at her leg, having a Charlie horse and having to be medically evacuated from it.
And she is, of course, scared of ladders.
Yeah, I worked at my first job was at a dollar store, and I had a few bit of a fear of heights on unstable objects, and we had to use this 10-foot ladder to get some of the heavier boxes. So the first couple times I used it, I was just shaking the whole time going up, and even on the way down, because I have to carry the heavy box in one hand and balance with the other, and the ladder was a bit wobbly. So that, if they just put her through that before the race, she'd probably get over her fear of ladders in no time.
Yeah, I mean, at 6'5", I am responsible for climbing a lot of ladders at work, so I'm kind of over it. Although, I get what you mean about unstable ladders. I am really not a fan of them.
Oh, there was a funny joke in their bio that I found amusing. So you said, because they're both in the what is it? They're both cops now. They work at separate police stations, and I guess they met through, what was it, the Canadian Armed Forces. So their navigational skills, they say, are really good, where Cynthia says she really likes maps, and Brian does well with Bush. So I'm thinking, wow, Brian, way too much information. Way too much information.
And their quote about how they, or what their strategy is going to be, is it's about winning. There aren't too many chances to be truly dirty. There are U-turns, but it's part of the game. I don't even think it's playing dirty, it's tactical. What happened to them being sort of lone wolves? Natalie and Megan would never use a U-turn. That's so un-Canadian. We're hockey heroes, guys.
They're not following in the footsteps of who they aspire to be.
How do you rate their chances then?
8th place, I think. I think after they are eliminated, Cynthia will be taking the poppy out of her bag and be mourning the loss of her position in the race.
And I have them as a very early boot. They may very well be first boot for me, actually. They're not as strong a first boot as Shala and Nabila were, but they're sort of a tentative first boot.
Are you saying that? I think a comparison just came to mind for me. So is it fair to say that they can be compared to, say, Deborah and Steve from The Amazing Race 4? Just that middle-aged, really serious, slightly out-of-shape couple that is just bound to go down early and doesn't quite fit in with how the race usually goes?
I'm not sure how fit they're going to be. I know that law enforcement teams especially tend to have quite a good endurance and that sort of stuff, but I just don't get it from them. I'm just not sure. Deborah and Steve is a very good comparison. I wouldn't be shocked if they're first boot, put it that way.
Neither would I. That's why I put them around 8th, just because I think there's other teams that could be eliminated for more immediate reasons, like Nick and Sabrina not being able to swim all that well, for instance, or Dane and Amanda not really seeming like they have skills that would directly translate to the race.
Or a personality.
From what the bio says, who knows what they are like in real life.
But that's the whole point of doing a preview. It's to be unnecessarily mean about everyone involved and then have to backtrack in the 12 weeks following, like I've done with Suki and Jinder this week. Because upon Mark Carroll's recommendation, I re-listened to our segments about Suki and Jinder last year and cringed.
Cringe?
Oh.
What did we say? That was so bad.
They don't seem to be that interesting either. Another team that's going to wind me up a bit. I told them to get a life, although not as angry as Gino and Jesse. Apparently they've watched the first season hundreds of times. They really need to get a life.
Oh man. Whatever you do, listeners, do not tweet out the link for Amazing Race 2 Canada preview podcast to Suki and Jinder. We wanna remember the good times of the other 12 episodes where we talk very well of them.
Even funnier, I tweeted about it last weekend, and out of the blue, Jinder favorited the tweet. I didn't even tag him in it.
Maybe they listen to us more than we think.
Yeah. You sounded so ill on that preview, by the way.
So ill as in, like, ugh, you know, Logan sounds ill, or like ill as in I was coughing and sneezing the whole time.
Like, so full of a cold.
Well, that's because with last summer, the house I used to live at, everybody that lives in my area, at the other place for about 15 years, we all always had really bad allergies around June and July. And then I moved to the other side of town at the end of last summer, pretty much right when the season Canada 2 was about to end. And this summer has rolled around, and I don't have those same allergies that I've always had for the past several years. So I think it's just the change of the air on this side of town or certain plants or trees that exist around here. So I haven't really been sneezing as much as I used to or be sniffling all the time and sound like my throat is all dried up.
You also said that Suki and Jinder would annoy you as much as Nick and Star.
Oh, we're sorry, Suki and Jinder.
I would like to offer a formal apology. We know you're badass.
Speaking of who isn't badass, with Brian and Cynthia, a lot of the complaints on the Amazing Race Canada page that we've made fun of over the past 3 years.
Logan, we've made fun of things?
We've made fun of things. We've made fun of casual fans, yes. On the Amazing Race Canada page, we touched upon this last week, where everybody complains that there's not even proportion geographic representation of who is on the race. And we've touched upon as to why this is quite extensively. But Brian and Cynthia are the only team from the prairies, correct?
As far as I know, yeah.
So, the most common complaint is that people were saying, oh, they don't really cast teams from the prairies. There's nobody from Alberta. There's nobody from Saskatchewan. Well, guess what? The lone prairie representation is Brian and Cynthia. And out of the 32 teams in Amazing Race Canada history, I am going out of my way to say that Brian and Cynthia are going to be the most boring team out of all 32 teams that we are ever going to have. And that's the only team that they are able to get from the prairie. So it's not producer's fault, prairie folks. It's your fault. It's your fault.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just looking at the Amazing Race Canada Facebook page at the moment, 16 hours ago, just curious as to why there's no team from Alberta.
And they'll get a quadrillion likes. Is that just like being at this point? Like, what if I say, oh, I can't believe you cast any teams from Alberta or Saskatchewan. Am I just going to suddenly become the most popular person on the Amazing Race Canada Facebook page?
Post right below it, are they leaving Canada for three quarters of the race, or are they staying in Canada for most of it again? It's only amazing when you leave your own country for most of it, where you have a language barrier, different cultures and traditions, different food, etc.
Yeah, I've already got, like, ever since I did the article a week ago for the funny complaints that we see on the page, I've already found eight more that I find hilarious, and I even had to cut out a couple of the, oh, I can't believe you're not going to stay in Canada ones. There's one on there that's really passive-aggressive, which I find particularly hilarious.
Also, just as an exclusive, Logan and I were offered to go to CTV's Media Day, but we had to turn it down because of flights.
Well, yeah, because we were the only available flights were WestJet, and I'm not sure if you've seen the news lately, but somebody's been calling in about five or six fake bomb threats to WestJet over the past week, so this has been mainly through, I think, Edmonton, Calgary, and then there was one that was just in Toronto where they had to call in the RCMP to search the plane, but none of these bomb threats have panned out. So that's why my ticket ultimately didn't go through, because my flight got delayed, and I couldn't take part in the media day, so, you know, I didn't get to spit in James Duffy's face. I didn't get to yell and shout curse words at the four people from the social. And I didn't get to kick sand in Devin Sultan Deek's eyes. So I missed out on all the golden opportunities on the CTV Media Day for the Amazing Race Canada 3.
The official term is harpies from the social. That is the term we use.
Ooh, harpies? Can you use it in a sentence?
A grasping, unpleasant woman. If you want me to use it in a sentence, Google has offered one. Clearly, he had us down as a couple of gold-digging harpies. So shall we move on to Simi and 4chan's favourite, Opie?
Yes, let's do that. So I propose, so that we don't get in trouble on this podcast, and we want to keep this podcast clean, whenever we say Simi and Opie's last name, I suggest we just drop the first syllable and just say the Bombays, or the Bombies, rather. Which, coincidentally, it's similar to the nickname the Bong Pete's, which was Mickey and Pete's nickname, I believe, in the Amazing Race Canada 2. Or we go the Stephen Colbert way, and we say their last name backwards. I have to point out, though, because many of our listeners aren't even from Canada, but there's actually a pretty legit connection between British Columbia and Nigeria, because when I was, well, just growing up here locally, pretty much the only major minority representation where I live, because we're the whitest region of BC, is mainly East Indian and Chinese, is pretty much our two major minority demographics. But we actually, within my town, we have a sister city within Nigeria. So we don't really have much of an African-Canadian population, but pretty much 100% of African Canadians were from Nigeria through the Sister City Exchange Program. And my eldest brother, the only African Canadian guy that he lived with during his college wrestling days, I don't know if he lived with him, he trained with him anyways, was Daniel Galley. And of course, he's the one that won the gold medal at the Sydney Olympics, and he was a Nigerian Canadian.
So basically, what you're saying is that it's very possible in Amazing Race Canada 4 that we could be seeing a Nigeria leg.
Well, it's not politically stable right now. That's the thing we learn in university, especially especially northern Nigeria, if anything. There's no way they would visit that area of the country. Because when I was in university, I got to talk to the author of one of the books we read in the Central African political science course. So I think, if anything, they would only be visiting one of the major cities along the south coast, I believe. Okay, so for the Bong Bees here, Wasini and Opie, I hope that they are nothing like Hussein and Natasha from Amazing Race Asia 4. That's my biggest fear, because I do see some personality similarities, but Hussein in the Amazing Race Asia 4, for those of you who haven't seen it, he's just imagine Gino and Jesse, but the same. He's the same as Gino and Jesse. He's that bad.
I was going to say, he's basically your Gino and Jesse.
He is my Gino and Jesse. He is my Gene, and he is my Karen from Survivor Palau as well.
Having said that, you're not particularly high on Gino and Jesse either, thankfully.
But yeah, Hussein was just the most irritating guy out of everybody to participate in the Amazing Race Asia. He would just quit everything and still be rewarded for it. Like, and towards the end of the season, him and Natasha had a lead, and they did this task that you would see in almost any season of Amazing Race, and he decided not to do it. And then he took a 4-hour penalty, so the other team just got to win the race very, very easily without any suspense.
And Opie is Simi's hero, and he repays her by saying that if they win the money, he wants to buy a house for his son.
You noticed that too? I wrote it down. I wrote down a little. I wrote down a financial map where I wrote down. Simi is going to give her prize money to her parents. And Opie is one of her parents, and Opie wants to give his prize money to his son. So the son gets to reap all the benefits from however well they do on this season.
And go on a cruise with his wife as well.
Simi gets nothing, in other words. Everybody else in the family wins money except for her. She's in a lose-lose situation.
And they most associate with the Timms, obviously, as the most successful parent-child team. And yay for British Columbia representation, finally.
Yeah, Burnaby, that's where my brother lived for a bit, I have several brothers, but that's where my eldest brother lived during his college wrestling days.
Isn't that the place that Nate from Big Brother Canada 2 was from?
Yes, it was.
And did you notice what his favourite travel destination is?
Home? Which I assume is not referring to Burnaby, but rather to Nigeria, I hope.
Home is such an awful answer to that question. I may actually have to do a post on, here's the generic questions that they'll ask you on a talk bio, do not answer this. This is stupid. And they are both scared of snakes.
Yeah, actually, during the racing special as well, Devin was trying to figure out who had the heaviest backpack. And interestingly enough, he lifted Simi's backpack, and he said it's the heaviest backpack he's lifted over the past couple seasons. So I guess even though we were making fun of other teams like Max / Khaleesi, Max and Elias for packing two straight flat irons, I know it was like either curling or straight or flat, but whatever, who the hell cares?
I was going to say, can you not tell from her profile picture?
But with Simi there, yeah, I'm surprised she's the one with the heaviest backpack because, you know, she's pretty much the smallest racer overall on this season. She doesn't look like somebody who wants to be as fashionable as, say, Brent and Sean or even like Dana and Amanda or some of the other teams or Nick and Matt who want to carry a bunch of protein stuff as well.
Maybe she's just got a lot of cute outfits.
Could be. Very strong possibility. And also in the Ready, Set, Race, which was a terrible title for the CTV preview, by the way, I guess Opie admitted that he's not very good in water, which is the same as Nick and Sabrina.
And also completely adheres to the stereotype.
Yeah, I'm not one to really joke about that because I don't think it's really something worth joking about. But with all these seasons of Amazing Race and Survivor, it just really opens your eyes that that's just maybe it's not even reinforcing the stereotype, but just a stereotype that I may have some overall truth to it, I guess.
And their strategy quote is, we follow our own path, we're comfortable enough that when we're convinced about what we're doing, we don't mind going out on our own, integrity is huge for us. So they're basically Natalie and Megan.
Yeah, they were really, a lot of teams this season aren't willing to do anything sneaky, supposedly, or do anything that compromises their image, which makes sense for like the athletic and law enforcement teams, but I mean, CME is a business relations person was her official occupation. And then Opie's job was, he had like some obscure title. Oh, distribution logistics coordinator. A job that flows well when you want to say it fast.
We have a lot of euphemistic job titles this season, actually. Because like on the official CTV bio, Hamilton and Michaela basically said that we work in customer service. I had to go digging to find out it was Tim Hortons.
Is that like bartenders on newer seasons of Survivor that say they're mixologists?
Well, mixology is actually studying bartending, I think. I think if someone says they're a bartender, they basically just work there out of university. Whereas I think if they're a mixologist, they actually do it professionally.
I see. The more you learn.
How do you rate Simi and Opie's chances then?
Sadly, I have them going first.
We're differing on a first boot. I don't think they'll be first. I think they'll be pretty early there.
How early?
I'd say probably first three legs.
Yeah, I think they'll be. I think I originally had them in 11th. And I'm like, no, they'll probably just go first because they don't come off super competitive. For instance, Opie seems super relaxed, and then Simi, and just in their bio, it seems like winning is secondary to them, and it's more about just them wanting to be on a vacation and bond with each other. I don't think the race is really on their mind too much. And they're not going to be, like, Simi doesn't have aspirations to be a model, and Opie's not trying to become an actor, so there's not even much of a motivation for them to try and get as much screen time as possible. They're the furthest removed from being the Mactor type.
I certainly don't think that they're going to be getting to about halfway. I'll be very surprised if they do. So, team number 10 is the aforementioned Nick and Matt, who are a professional wrestling team known as the Flatliners or Asylum and Burns. And by day, they are a school teacher and estate agent, respectively.
On the Ready, Set, Race thing, Devin asked them, oh, what was your worst tag team nickname in wrestling? And they said that their worst one was called Hate Machine.
What? It's just such a stupid one.
Yeah, that's why they said it was their worst.
Yeah. I have quite high hopes for them. Because
they were pretty hilarious in their bios and in their... They had that interview with that weird lady from The Social as well as a clip. And then also, yeah, one of the... A quarter of the Harpies.
I can't even remember where the Harpies from The Social came from. I think it might have been something we reinforced after season one.
And then on this Ready, Set, Race clip, they're just naturally funny guys.
I think they are naturally funny, and they're well-traveled, which are two very dangerous things for other teams.
Mm-hmm. Well, wrestlers don't really have a reputation of being early exits on The Amazing Race.
No, they tend to be sort of fourth through sixth. At least.
Yeah, they're so I actually have these guys pegged as being fourth place overall. And they just, there's no outstanding weakness for them from what I can tell.
I can definitely see them being the disappointing last boot.
Mm-hmm.
It would break my heart, I suspect, if they went in fourth, which probably means they're going to go in fourth.
The only disappointing thing about them is that they're naturally funny guys, but they have the most G-rated type sense of humor, and especially with Nick because he's a first grade school teacher, so I think he's not going to be the type to, you know, start dropping F-bombs while traveling, so he knows he's on camera and potentially lose his teaching job.
Max and Elias,
but,
in other words.
Yeah, the exact opposite of Max and Elias. But I think it'll still be funny enough, even within that really clean, squeaky clean type of humor, that it won't really get to me at all.
Yeah, they've traveled extensively together, including around the US and Japan, and spent hundreds of hours in a car together.
And it sounds like hundreds of hours traveling with Hulk Hogan.
Please never do that impression again.
If they get to, they should have Hulk Hogan at the U-turn board, And then Nick and Matt are faced with the dilemma, and then Hulk Hogan is just standing there saying, "What you gonna do, brother?"
And with the money, Nick wants to finish renovating his house and be in a good financial position. And Matt would like to explore a new career option, potentially being the second racer in this cast who wants to be a firefighter.
He does not strike me as somebody who would be a real estate agent and also a wrestler.
No, and also, his nickname would be so ironic if he became a firefighter. Because I'm assuming he's the Burns bit of Asylum and Burns.
Asylum and Burns? Your nickname is Burns? We're going to hire you to be a firefighter?
Excellent.
Especially in Canada, where we're just having fires everywhere right now.
Yeah, well, it's the dry season, isn't it?
Super dry. There's been thousands of people evacuated out of Saskatchewan, so they're probably, I think they're in some emergency area in Alberta, and hopefully they're so bored that they're listening to this podcast right now. And then there was a building that burned down just about 10 blocks away from me.
So what you're saying is it's caused literally tens of dollars of damage in Saskatchewan.
Yeah, tens of dollars in Saskatchewan, yes. And there's just been a bunch of other fires as well, so he's probably going to get into the business at the right time because, you know, they're probably the governments, provincially and nationally, are going to be hiring as many firefighters as they can.
As I mentioned earlier in the week, Wednesday was the hottest day on record in July ever.
In Britain?
Yeah, at 37 degrees.
Yeah, we've already had a couple of 40 degree days here.
It's never ever got that warm, and it was so humid. It's been awful this week in terms of humidity, because it was like 80% humidity most days.
So would that be the perfect day to go to London there and just smell all of the aroma around London?
Yeah, it would have been a very smelly day in London on Wednesday.
Could you imagine if they had like that 40 degree day on, say, Masonry's Canada 1 or 2 with one of the fish sorting tasks?
Well, from what I've heard, at least one of the India legs was taking place during a very, very, very bad heat wave. One that killed people, actually.
6,000.
So that's going to be hilarious on television to watch, because someone is going to blatantly get heatstroke.
That's why there was no teams from Yukon, Northwest Territories, or Nunavut this season, because if they had to go through the India leg, I'm pretty sure that team would die.
Yeah. And they commit another pet peeve on the bios. They can't compare themselves to anyone.
We're copied, never imitated.
As much as I kind of get the reasoning for it, seriously, guys, just come up with someone. Make it Jet and Dave, because otherwise we have to honorarily put you as Jet and Dave like last season.
We can probably come up with a much more flattering comparison than Jet and Dave.
Having said that, last season there was one team that definitely had no comparison that we mocked for it and honorarily made them Jet and Dave, and that was Suki and Jinder.
Ooh, that's an interesting point.
As far as I know, Suki and Jinder were the only team last season not to do a comparison.
I think the reason why they can't be compared, besides Nick's facial hair, that one of the other teams on the race during the race at Race Special coined as being the most perfectly trimmed beard he's ever seen, Matt has a green toque. And it's not even super douchey-type duke. It's toque. It actually looks fashionable on him.
Logan's style advice, then.
Yes. Are we bringing back that segment from Amazing Race 25?
Well, given my rant about people's clothing last week, it kind of fits.
Actually, there is somebody I compared Matt to, and it's not an Amazing Racer. It's a character from the Netflix series BoJack Horseman. There's the human character that lives in BoJack's apartment. And he looks a bit like Matt because he wears the same toque. So Matt is essentially compared Matt to an 18-year-old guy who just couch serves in the house of a horse.
Yeah, pretty
famous
much.
Horse.
And they are both scared of snakes, so it's probably for the best that they didn't go to Hong Kong.
And it's probably best that Tommy Lee wasn't cast for this season. And did you see that one of Matt's rules is that he has a no fanny pack policy at home. That's one of his rules in the bio. There's a no fanny pack policy.
That's going to serve him well when racing around the world.
Yeah, that's how you lose your passport. Just ditch the fanny pack.
Just ask another fourth place team, Tony and Dallas.
Now Dallas is just so paranoid that he has a fanny pack, has a titanium clip attached around his body to make sure he always has a fanny pack on him at all times. over the past 10 years.
And their strategy quote is, "Our plan is definitely not to play dirty, but when it comes down to not having the grand prizes, I'd rather be the prize winner."
They have a really weird quote too, where they said, we're there to be beaten, which is a very low-aiming goal to have on the race.
We could literally Schaller and Nabila it and succeed.
And Matt had a couple of other interesting points too. He says that he loves room escape games, so I wonder if he has either 9 hours, 9 persons, 9 doors for the Nintendo DS, or if he's also played Virtue's Last Reward Zero Escape. Okay, that's the game he probably has for the 3DS. And he also said that his most prized item is shampoo. Oh, no, not shampoo. Actually, it's my Mach 3 razor. So what I gather from that is that Nick and Matt are going to be making a lot of jokes about being bald, and that could get old really fast.
Weirdly, my local RuneScape game followed me out of the blue on Twitter a couple of days ago. I have never even contacted them. And then they sent me a DM saying, "Why don't you come down?" I'm like, "What if I had any friends?" They've not responded. So, are we going with fourth place for them?
For the wrestlers, I think that's a pretty solid bet. I think we can go with fourth place.
I get the sort of Suki and Jinder-style disappointing exit vibe from them, definitely. Hopefully they won't get on our nerves.
Especially with their modest team nickname, according to the Loop article, which was Team Super Cool Dudes. So they're super modest as well, I guess.
And now we're going to the team that I was probably most excited about preseason before really getting the bios. Because I love an X team. X's teams are always sources of hilarity.
Yes, between Tara and Will and Tim and Marie.
And Adam and Rebecca.
And Adam and Rebecca, although, were they already split even before the race started?
Yeah, I think they were split. I think their point of going on the race was Adam's point of going on the race was to try and win her back.
Yeah, that didn't work out. She switched teams.
She certainly did. So it's Dujon and Leilani, who are friends and exes. She's sharp-witted and a musical theatre performer, and he is one of Canada's number one crumpers. I was under the impression that crumpers is a breakfast food.
I thought Crumper was the name of an enemy from Donkey Kong Country, along Crushes and Critters, and what are some other enemies from Donkey Kong Country? Help me out here, Michael.
To be fair, I've not got that far into it because I just don't have the patience for the long levels that I keep dying on. And with the monies, they want to buy a dance studio, and they are one of two teams that we know of who said their pop duo name would be Sugar Spice and Whole Wheat Rice.
Whole Wheat Rice.
Yeah, Whole Wheat Rice was the bit that they included. And they most associate with Mickey and Pete.
Which I don't know why.
No, neither do I. Probably the Ontario connection, let's be honest.
Oh, and there's a big tip-off as to why these two could be gone early. Because Leilani has inhalers in her backpack.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Could we see another comparison to Tara and Will then?
Yeah. Well, they're running to the finish line. Dujon, they have a big lead on, one of the teams that are probably going to make it to the finish line this season.
Max and Elias.
Max and Elias, yeah. So Max and Elias are like 10 minutes behind, and Dujon and Leilani just have to, run a quarter of a mile to the finish line. They're at the location, they're out of their taxi, and then Dujon starts breakdancing on his way to the finish line. He starts crumping, he's getting down, he's doing the robot, He's really getting into it because he knows he's got this in the bag. But then Leilani just has the biggest asthma attack in the world. And, she's puffing herself up with some salbutamol, some Ventolin, just really trying to get the oxygen going. But then they have to stop and slow down. And then Max and Elias just walk by them, probably say F yeah or something like that, just cursing on their way onto the finish line. And then Max and Elias become the winners of the Amazing Race Canada 3.
I would be very interested to see whether a entrance by a winning team has had to be refilmed because it was just swear words.
Yeah. Like Chris Doherty's Survivor Vanuatu, where he just screams the F-bomb upon winning.
Exactly. I would be very interested to see whether that actually happens. Because we've had, the best part of 60 seasons now. Surely someone has screamed a swear word when they've won.
You would think so. Or maybe it was Phil Kogan that said the F word, where he said, 8 countries, 30,000 effing miles or something like that. And just because he's a potty mouth off screen, sort of like Jeff Probst is. And he's like, oh no, oh no, reshoot.
To be fair, it was probably Grant Bowler. Because he gets very excited when a team wins, because that's the only time he's allowed to be excited at all season. He's just like, F-bombs for everyone! F yeah, it's Daniel and Ryan.
Or in the Amazing Race 6 when Freddie and Kendra across the finish line, Phil Coburn just said, all right, we're going to shoot what we're going to show for the finale, but just know that I don't care about either of you guys.
And his fear is drowning, and she's scared of spiders.
Yeah, Dujana has a fear of drowning.
If they have a deep water task, could be interesting for him.
If the water is ruthless, you say? Do you think he's going to keep going with the ruthless nickname throughout the season?
Hopefully not, because it's stupid.
Like when he goes to U-turn a team, he's going to say, oh, you know, I got a U-turn them. Ruthless Dujon.
Well, to be fair, both of their strategy quotes were very ruthless. He said, I want to win, I'd play dirty, and I wouldn't give two rats, you know? And she said, playing fair's nice, but do you get remembered for it, really?
No, you do not. Because then you end up like, who's a team that we don't really care about in the Amazing Race Canada?
Jody and Corey?
Yes. Yeah, I would say that's a pretty good example. What else? Oh, yeah, they probably have the most interesting story of how they met. They met by watching Friends in a rat battle. Yeah, I don't think that's ever happened before where Amazing Race team has met through a rap battle.
So, how do you rate their chances?
Let's see. If the inhalers don't come into play too early on in the game, I see them making it as far as 7th, but I don't think that we'll see them last too far into the season.
I have hopes that they'll last for a while, but I wouldn't be surprised if they don't.
You know what else was interesting about them is that, I guess, Dujon was dancing so much that during the Ready, Set, Race special that all the other teams were saying, oh yeah, he's a really good dancer. He was just crumping the whole time during the interview process and around the hotel.
Yeah, if they get a dance task, they will ace it, I suspect. Because Amazing Race Canada loves a dance task.
Yeah, but everybody is preparing for dance tasks and memorization this season, especially the memory ones. At least 7 or 8 teams had that in their bio. So that's the problem with the new franchise, is that, especially with Amazing Race, is that if you have the same type of tasks over and over, you pretty much have to cast recruits. Otherwise, you're just going to be full of teams who know exactly what tasks are going to be on the horizon, and nobody is really going to struggle.
And our final team is the new Stephen Alley, Neil and Kristen.
I thought they could potentially have Duke and Lauren vibes, personally.
I've thought this since the bios were announced, that they don't necessarily have Stephen Alley vibes, but they are going for the Stephen Alley demographic.
I think so, too, which means they won't get any airtime whatsoever.
CTV wants us to love them, though.
Oh, they're trying really hard. They're really pushed. They were even mentioning, the son. They were even mentioning that the son was a CFL player turned Olympian bobsledder.
Yeah, they are enthusiastic and humorous, according to the bio. Mm-hmm. And they mentioned that Nielsen and Kristen's brother Jesse is a former CFL player and now an Olympian under bobsled. Which, you know, as we've previously talked about the bobsled with Steve from last American season, about how it's an inherently dangerous sport, but, you know, kind of badass. And yeah, they are one of two teams that I definitely get the feeling that CTV wants us to love them.
The other being Brett and Sean?
Yeah. Brett and Sean got a lot of love in their bio from CTV.
With Neil and Kristen, it's... Yeah, I don't think they'll receive too much airtime because they are definitely more subtle. Neil seems like a fairly quiet guy, and then Kristen's the outgoing one, I would say, but she's not interesting per se. She has the one, I guess, the one aspect about her that they are really pushing the bio is that she overcame multiple learning disabilities, I guess, to get through school. So clearly she's driven. But with these two, yeah, I think they were just cast because they're marketable to the portion of the fan base where they don't really care about entertaining teams. They just want quote-unquote nice/patriotic Canadian teams.
Yeah, they were cast purely for the patriotism. Because we've not... Throughout this season, we have not got any team who is kind of semi-famous until Neil and Kristen.
Mm-hmm. I had no idea who Neil was, by the way.
Neither did I, but I'm not Canadian, so I've got an excuse.
Yeah. But yeah, I had no idea who the guy was. It didn't ring a bell. Even when I saw a picture of him, I'm thinking, who the hell is that?
Logan, don't you know that he's a three-time Grey Cup winner with the Edmonton Eskimos?
Yeah, I know. I recognized Elias within about 0.1 seconds, but Neil is just one, just nothing. No bells ringing.
The thing that sort of worries me for them is they have very similar strengths and weaknesses. A
Yeah,
good team
very
balances
similar.
each other out.
I like how Neil's complained about Kristen is that she talks too much, yet she's the one that's, yet if she wasn't talking, they'd probably have zero confessionals each episode.
Yeah, he's a know-it-all and she's too loud, apparently.
I find it fitting that a guy who was in the CFL comes from a town named Burlington.
I think I might have passed through there.
Really? Did you see Neil there?
No, I didn't. He might have waved as the train went past.
Hey guys, hey Harmstones, I'm going to be on the Amazing Race Canada 3. Remember me.
On the subject of memorization tactics, she has a photographic memory, apparently.
Which means she's going to screw up at a memory test?
Almost certainly, because you have to remember that the bios tend to be written before the season, but then can be tweaked up until the release by the teams. So the fact that it appears in there probably means that something's going to go wrong for them.
Did you know how little Neil cared about this race? Kristen picked out his entire wardrobe except for his shoes.
He really was just rung up by someone from casting going, "Do you have someone who you can race with? Are you free?"
I wonder if there was just a mass email, like, because you said with Mally Megan that they just contacted Hockey Canada and said, hey, give us two people. And they said, okay, we'll give you Mally and Megan. But with here, I wonder if they contacted Football Canada or just sent out a mass chain email to every present and past player on the CFL roster over the past 30 years and said, hey, any of you guys interested in being on the Amazing Race Canada?
It's quite noticeable that there is nothing in their bio about their preparation for the race, which probably means they were cast about 5 days before.
I think Neil said that he'd switch to cardio and less power type workouts before the race, but that's been it.
I don't think they had much time to prepare. I'm pretty sure they were recruits.
Kristen has probably the best fear out of anybody this season, I think.
Centipedes!
Centipedes. There's a joke there, but we're not gonna make
Yeah, it's not Amazing Race Israel, Logan.
it.
Because Amazing Race Israel would probably try and recreate that. Could you imagine that intersection?
That's an intersection nobody wants to see.
Or just a penalty to have the last two teams have to be chained together.
And Kristen likes carrots because they're long, sweet, and crunchy.
Don't need to go there, really, do we, other?
We can press pause on that.
And they don't think you have to be dirty to win. Which, to be fair, neither team that has won the race used a U-turn, I don't think.
In Canada, yeah. Kindness has been rewarded.
So, how do you rate their chances?
Not in the words that you.
Not
Not good.
good!
I have them as around ninth. And can I mention how happy I am that they cast two father-daughter teams on the same season, rather than it just being one father-daughter team? Because in the Amazing Race Asia, and I think in the US as well, when they had Jim and Marcia on, the production always pushed, oh, you're the first ever father-daughter team to be on the Amazing Race. And then when Hussein and Natasha made it halfway through the race, then Alan Wu would say, hey, out of all the father-daughter teams, nobody, the father-daughter team has never made it this far. And you just want to shake Wu by his shoulders and say, hey, Alan, that's because they're the only father-daughter team that's ever been cast for the race. So I think by casting two father-daughter teams to break the barrier, so to speak, for Amazing Race Canada, production can't do this father-daughter pioneering crap.
May I just point out as well, Wu is on fire at the moment. If you don't follow Alan Wu on Facebook, do it now. He's amazing.
Yes, I have been following his travels for Amazing Race China, where apparently they love to leak out every location they're going as they film it. And with Alan Wu, he's going through Greece, he's going through Turkey.
His puns were on fire. Kanga Wu is still my favorite, but
Kangaroo? Kangaroo? Did he ride in the pouch?
he actually used the hashtag Kanga Wu.
Oh, How did I miss out on that? I borderline stalked this guy on Facebook and Twitter.
He's such a legend, I love him. So yeah, Neil and Kristen probably aren't going to last that long, let's be honest.
And even if they do, we're not going to really know much about them. It's just going to be, Neil's going to be like Uncle Rico, and he's going to be talking about his CFL days, and they're going to be in a mountainous area, maybe within either BC or elsewhere in Canada that has mountains, and he's going to be at the pit stop, and he's going to talk to the producers and say, hey guys, hey Monty, think I could throw this football over the mountain?
You know for a fact that Monty is going to mention the fact that they're related to an Olympian.
Oh yeah, Monty eats that crap up all the time.
That's the sort of
all the producers do.
Yeah, Monty especially is big on his Olympian knowledge.
That's all he just wants to brag, like, oh, I know which Canadian won the gold medal at the 1976 Olympics in Montreal. I know everybody. I know them on a first name basis. I know their children and their children's children.
So, should we talk about the twists finally? The major twist of the season is a new challenge element called the face-off, which is added to the competition. Now, after a little bit of digging, I'm assuming that this is the double battle, coined by Amazing Race Israel.
Also known as Hammerot's Lemillion.
Amazing Race Israel, of course, being the best franchise because of how ridiculous their tests are and the psychological warfare that they put the races under.
People need to for any Hebrew listeners out there, please post English subtitles for every episode of Hammerot's Lemillion, that's the Israeli version of Amazing Race, and do it for all four seasons, because if you're just bored, just go through the Wikipedia page for each of the four seasons and read through the tasks, and tell me with a straight face that you don't think that that's not worth watching.
Anyone who knows me knows that I love a good foreign television program, regardless of whether it's got English subtitles or not. I'm decent with French programs, currently watching French Mole and Fort Bayard, which is the best adventure show of all time. But like Dutch Mole, I'll watch with English subtitles. If someone can give me English subtitles, I will eat the shit up of Hammerots. But yeah, I love Hammerots' tasks. From the detail where they made teams eat cake ingredients, including a raw egg and a candle, to the taking them to Las Vegas and simulating what the Mafia does by burying someone alive for half an hour.
30 minutes.
That was in the same season. That was season 3. Or the round where the penalty for coming in last was having to wear your winter weather gear when we went to Brazil, and then having, in the Brazilian leg, a fast forward which involved naked volleyball. The producers are evil for Hammerots, but they're awesome.
So let's talk about this face-off twist, which is right from Amazing Race Israel. Let's rephrase it for those who are not familiar with this twist before.
Basically, in the double battle, two teams will go head-to-head in the same task. It's usually some sort of relay race or silly task, like playing strip poker in a limo, and the first team to give up have to go back to the start, the next team get a clue. And the last team standing usually has some sort of penalty or embarrassing task to do, like walking around the streets of Las Vegas wearing nothing but a sandwich board saying, I lost a game of strip poker. Strip poker. Mm-hmm. Actually happened. And yeah, some of it'll be used to weed out some of the weaker teams. Like, I don't see Brian and Cynthia winning a face-off, for example.
And I hope we never have to see them lose a game of strip poker.
Yeah, something tells me that after last season, they may not go the strip route for a while.
With a lot of the Canadian viewers, we're not that progressive, where if there was that sort of task, there'd be so much viewer outrage, because Amazing Race Canada is a quote-unquote family show, and a task like that just wouldn't be well-received, and there'd be so many angry people saying, oh, you know, this is, you know, what are you guys doing? This is immoral, this is unethical, this is worse than when you made them eat the snake bile, this is worse than spitting on a few potatoes, oh, you guys are the worst, blah, 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 blah.
I wouldn't be surprised if we have, like, a water polo match as a face-off. That's the sort of thing that they like to do.
They should have an ice hockey face-off. Go meta.
A face-off, face-off, face-off.
Yes, Nicolas Cage and John Travolta are playing ice hockey on the Amazing Race Canada during the face-off. Oh man, that's a triple entendre.
Which team do you think will have the most trouble with a potential face-off?
I think I had a fairly good contender for that. Let's see. I was thinking probably Simi and Opie, wouldn't be too competitive with other teams during the face-off. Maybe Dana and Amanda would be major choke artists. Neil probably wouldn't really care.
Yeah, is Neil just going to phone it in all season, do we reckon?
I think so. He's actually... Oh, I know what I was going to say. Neil is 62 years old, and I believe that puts him as one of the... probably pretty much the oldest Amazing Race contestant that we've had in quite a few years.
Yeah, if they get U-turned, will he complain about it being inappropriate to U-turn an old man?
No, because he's not an entitled diva like David O'Leary is.
And that's rude.
That's rude, yes. But yeah, have we had anybody over the age of 60 on any season of Amazing Race since Bill and Kathy?
Not that I can think of off the top of my head. Definitely not last season. Actually, I think Israel had a grandparents team.
And they were out first?
Second, actually.
Sounds about right.
57 and 60, respectively.
And how old were Bill and Kathy?
Bill was 63, Kathy was 62.
Okay, so yeah, so Neil is the oldest racer since Bill and Kathy of the Amazing Race 19. Yeah, so that's quite a while to not have an older racer.
And I think he will live up to the stereotype of being a little bit rubbish.
And that's probably the reason why I see racers over the age of 60 is because they don't have a reputation of doing too well dating all the way back to season one.
For the record, by the way, Bill and Kathy are not rubbish. Bill and Kathy are legends.
They're not. No, Bill and Kathy are the furthest from rubbish. They are skeleton bones.
Bill and Kathy are some of my favorite joke targets we've ever used.
Yeah, actually, I think they're here with me right now, except we're not on video, so I can't show you the urn. They're lunging within my urn.
And what a beautiful way to wrap up this preview.
That's all 12?
Yeah, that's all 12 teams.
So I'm going to quickly run through my list of the 12 teams and my prediction, because we were a bit scared with doing it one at a time. So from last to first, here we go. Simi and Opie in 12th, Nick and Sabrina in 11th because of their water issues, Dean and Amanda in 10th, Neil and Kristen in 9th, the CFL career is not going to save them, Brian and Cynthia in 8th, but I hope they finish in 13th, then Dujon Leilani in 7th, Susan and Sharanjeet in 6th, Brent and Sean in 5th, Nick and Matt 4th, Malias in 3rd, Hamilton and Michaela in 2nd, and the worst outcome possible, because I'm pessimistic, the Gino and Jesse, the Canadian Satans, the Antichrist, and first taking the title.
Can we come up with a nickname for them so we don't actually have to refer to them ever again, please?
No, what, the Tangerines?
Yeah, Tangerines will do. We're going to come up with an off-air nickname for them because I don't want their names to be ever spoken again.
You know who? Voldemort. Voldemort. We can say Voldemort. Because Gino and Jesse, is that undesirable to say that Voldemort is more pleasant than Gino and Jesse?
They who shall not be named. So yeah, I think we're about done for the preview.
You think we're going to have a starting line elimination with these 12 teams? Or are we just going to have one fewer non-elimination? Or an idea that I thought of in my head is that one of the double, or I want to say double battle because Face Off is such a lame nickname. Like, we get it. We get that this is Amazing Race Canada and they like to shove ice hockey references down our throat. But calling it Face Off is just way too much. But I know that's what a core of the viewership of Amazing Race Canada loves, is that the series is all patriotic and that's why we have a bunch of athletes and law enforcement teams, because it's like we need to wave the Canadian flag every single round. But Face Off is just such a cringeworthy name that I just want to call it the double battle on every podcast.
Yeah, we can call it the double battle. But yeah, I'm pretty sure we're going to get a just one few non-elimination.
Nobody will be eliminated through the double battle?
No, I think that would be a completely bullshit way of doing it, shall we say.
Hasn't stopped Amazing Race producers before.
So, thank you very much for listening. You can join us this coming Friday, the 10th of July, to recap the premiere. If you enjoyed the show, and even if you didn't, please subscribe on iTunes. And if you want to see what we're rambling about this week, our Twitters are in the podcast description too. Also, if you've not heard the interview that we did with Amazing Race 26's Small Town Sweethearts, Micah and Michelle, that's also available on iTunes to listen to now. Thank you again.
Hashtag 250, hashtag Ginger Ninja, hashtag yatncast, hashtag Super Kawaki. Peace!
Peace out. A-Town. Yeah.